The action of the opera takes place in the 12th century and starts with the Battle of Menai Strait between the King of Norway, supported by Orkney and Shetland, and the Earl of Shrewsbury, supported by Wales. It was during this battle that Magnus first distinguished himself as a pacifist. The scenario then moves to Orkney and the quarrel between Harkon and Magnus, joint earls of Orkney, which culminates in the murder of Magnus by Harkon. After this, the action moves forward to the present day, and the martyrdom takes place in a police cell, similar to any in a contemporary totalitarian state. For the final scene, in which the blind crone, Mary, is cured of her blindness at Magnus's tomb, the action shifts back to the 12th century. The production takes place in extreme simplicity. The players and singers are now awaiting the entry of blind Mary, who, in a flashback, sings an Orkney spinning song. The wool is the guts of the soldiers to be killed in the impending battle. The weights on the warp their slaughtered heads. The spindles are spears bespattered with blood, weaving the web of victory. Blind Mary enters and rummages through her bag in search of an old cross, which she places on the coffin of St. Magnus.
Draw. are listening, Norsemen. The channel is narrow, Welshmen. There is not room for two ships to pass. Turn around, men. Back with you to the waves and mermaids. What men have come down from the north today so that their names may be carved on a gravestone at the shore?
Great heroes! Feet consider and say, God, stop! Ogmund, Finn, Thord, Eivind, Harry, Hakon, Magnus! Old Sigurd, face the ravens! They shake the sun from their shields! What is the name of the land behind you?
Anglesey, a fair and holy island.
We will land there for corn and women.
We welcome you to Anglesey with arrows in the Welsh fashion.
Battle.
A card would not be sitting in the very teeth of the swords. The man I straight is yours, king of Norway. A golden thunderbolt has fallen on Wales. Your queen will see you, Norway. You will show her your crown with a new and precious jewel. From the hand of the King of Norway to the princes and chiefs of the West. Now all the islands to the north and west of Britain are under the hand of Norway, from Faroe to sea, and Orkney is the chiefest earldom of these. Servant of Officer is Earl of Orkney, and that his brother, Earl of Officer, is Earl of Orkney also. May they govern long in peace and favour. And we declare that after Poland end, there shall govern son of Paul and Magnus, son of Erland, these two right royal and sweet and trusty servants who fought for us in the sea battle. And when I worthy therefore to be gathered into the one great music of the
Magnus with the Norsemen are now victorious. The keeper of the loom, the guardian of the soul of Magnus, brings his own dark opposite, the tempter, who presents Magnus with five temptations.
Oh, Thank you. meet me, my Lord Magnus. There is something I must show you, a certain worthy thing of particular interest to you. Your dead father, son, was good enough to repose in me a certain measure of trust. I standing so close to the throne in my office of chancellor, and so I hope my lord will you in an time. He then look the coat of state of the Earl of Orkney. Touch it, my lord Magnus. It's yours. Belongs to you, or rather it belongs both to you and Elhakon. But we can hardly slice the coat in two with a sword. There are not lacking ways and means whereby of a few years, Magnus Erlandson might be sold out in Orkney. On his shoulders alone could hang the coat of Erlandson.
Control of the situation.
has given us the perfect answer. It is this, that you become one of us in Einhau. There is a cell ready for you. There you can bide in peace for the rest of your days. Orkney must have a single urn. That is the only cure for all our troubles. Harkon is stronger than you. I have a boat ready.
Tell the abbot it is not right for a coward to wear the long, bright, holy coat. God has made me earl in this place. The harp is bleeding, I know it. My work is a work of peace, to bind up the wounds in the music. I must learn to harp when among the seven red beasts.
Magnus has withstood the temptations offered by the tempter. Finally, breaking the sword of battle, he's just accepted.
sing ballads in Gaelic, in English, as if having no ties of family or nation, you belong to one great brood. But when it comes to business, all this is wiped from your faces. We know the hard, cruel bone and the taste. Long the farmer in Ophir had no flitch of bacon for these Alhurkans men. He did not keep pigs.
The heralds of the warring earls, Magnus and Harkon, discuss a possible peace formula with the Bishop of Orkney. The meeting between Harkon and Magnus on the island of Egilsay is arranged.
Dominus Divisum, I have little time for you. The hospital is full. The brothers can't take in any more wounded men. They are always occupied, bandaging, praying, putting broth into mouths. You, O men, have given us plenty to do. A fine slaughterhouse you made of Orkney.
Father, we have a plan to bring peace. We want you to join us in putting this plan into action.
In Egilsay, there's to be a peace conference. In Egilsay, at least a Monday. It is important that you be there, Father. We do not
not invite you. We summon you. You must come. I'm sorry. I've no skill at patching up an old coat.
Oh,
premonition of treachery. Magnus is resolved to continue his crossing by boat to Egilsay to meet Earl Harkon.
We are not to proceed! Something frightful will happen if we land on Egilsay today. At the very least, the negotiations with El Hakon will not be a success. That wave was a warning to us.
My lord, I think we should turn back. It is cooler. At the soul of curious longing a single sudden mountain of salt in a salt vein. It almost swamped us. Sea has uttered a warning. It may be that nature has a wisdom hidden from man.
And now, my good angel, whom God has appointed to thee, my guardian, watch over me. Untimely death might still but what of the husbandman who is cut down by sudden sighs in the middle of the gleam? My mouth is ashes, dust, salt. If only we could look with the eye of an angel on the whole history of men, sub specie aeternatis, it would have the brevity and the beauty of the dance at the altar. Since all the round of time is gathered into this ritual altar dance, the actions of every man, once the bread of divine wisdom is in his body, his actions, thoughts will emanate through the whole web of time. Not yet one will be changed, either for good or for evil, by the things that his hands find to do. A man can therefore direct his purified will into the future. touched with healing by a right action in the present. I see myself in a mask of a beast, dragged to a myself in a long white corridor, leading to a small white cube.
you Someone. It seems I need a butcher, a tradesman who can chop meat and bones with a certain practice skill. Call it off, my cook and butcher. He is very good at his job, as we shall presently testify. We must come at once to the store on the hillside.
The action is moving forward through the centuries from the Viking past to the present day. Harkon has refused Magnus's offers of security and is resolved to execute him. News flashes report worsening negotiations between the two factions.
Rumors of dramatic new developments in the peace confrontation between the Paulson faction and the Erison faction have been coming from this lonely isle all through Sunday night and this morning. There is a blackout of news.
Neither of the parties is willing to give anything away. Through interviews with the crofters and fishermen and their wives, we have been able to build up a fairly definite picture. The Paulson, Erlandson deadlock seemed a week ago to be as intractable as ever, with all its bloody and tragic repercussions. Peace overtures have been made from time to time in the course of the past 16 months. The venue for this final scene is widely known, the island of Eggleston, which lies in a fairly neutral position between the Paulson and Erlandson power spheres.
Satisfaction, sir. How on earth am I going to lay hands on salmon or venison at this time of night?
Well spoken, Mr. Lithgow. It is simply a question of hanging a carcass.
Certainly, that will present no difficulty.
Mr. Lipholf, I begin to like you more and more. You answer like a true patriot, with promptness and a willingness to carry out orders.
My instruments are in the cookhouse. Could you please arrange for the carcass to be transferred to that part of camp?
Necessary. We have suitable premises known only to a few.
You will find the place of interest, Mr. Lithgow. It is filled with exactly the books of your trade in stainless steel.
Mr. Lithgow, I do not think that you are aware of the nature of the task that we are asking you to do. For any true patriot, it would be a great honor. You do not require to be told we are at war. We do not fear foreign soldiers. The enemy we fear is the enemy within our borders. Here in this camp, we have a special task to destroy such hostilities.
Mr. Lithgow, we proceed tonight with the elimination
of one of those enemies. A man is to be executed. For years, he has spread his heretical opinions. He was warned over and over. He was visited by the political police. He was given the opportunity to leave the country. We do not wish to touch him too closely. He has a certain world dream.
But he would not hold his tongue.
Such a thing, it is not my nature. I am a chef, not an executioner. I do not know the man, and it is inconceivable that I could do such a thing to another human being.
Mr. Leifolf, the decision has been made. And we will proceed to the execution at once. Everything has been prepared, Mr. Leopold. The prisoner will stand on the stool. Your duty will be simply to put the noose around his throat. I will raise my hand. That will be the sign. You will then pull the stool away. It is simple.
Oh,
The time is once more the 12th century. Blind Mary moves to the tomb of St. Magnus, there to pray for sight.
of bread.